Okay, so good evening everyone. So let's get started. Welcome to Ruby Tuesday and JavaScript Penang number 14, brought to you by the KL Ruby Gates and the JavaScript Malaysia group. This is our meetup link, so if you wanted to join our Slack, this is the Slack link that you can self-invite you into it. Wi-Fi. We have Wi-Fi password here. If you need, can pass you. And thank you for ECAP sponsoring our venue for this meetup. So introduce myself so I will see new faces. So I'm Gui, I'm the organizer of Ruby and JavaScript meetups. So I'm a software developer working remotely for your company. So let's get into the introduction from the new guy. Today our talk will be obfuscated Ruby JS design patterns, and the last one is what can I help you. So let's get started. Get my so we'll be doing a lot of cool sharing here with the Ruby side. So if you want to play around with Ruby, you can go to Replit to try out. So no experience needed for this one. You just need to choose Ruby and then can play with it. So this is like a notebook for you to play around with, the temporary notebook where it's having all the compiler on the browser itself where you can run the code here. So let's get started. Let's introduce about Ruby. So Ruby is easy to read and write, so wrong. Because Ruby is rich, flexible. It's easy to write, easy to read code, easy to read code, and easy to write, hard to read code. So it depends on you. Ruby is very flexible. You can write a very hard to read code. At the same time, you can write very, very fluid code where when you read the code, you know what it's doing. So can you read what this code does? This actual valid Ruby code. So let's get into the code. Let's see. So we'll be doing suppose. So this is the code. What it does is so let's decipher what that does. So if you want to write obfuscated Ruby code, here are three techniques. How to make a number with only symbols, how to make a string, and how to print a string. So how to make a number. So for this one, you can see that one add symbol equals to tilde dollar sign to equals to 1. So you can try this out. Do this here. Not here, this one. So we can put something here. second one. Let's see what's the second one. This one. Adding another one. So it returns 2. So this is one of the, I would say, one of the creative stuff that you can find in Ruby, where you can type your code with all the symbols so that no one knows what you're writing, but it's still a variable that runs your program. So for calculation making another number, you can assign 2 to underscore. So you can see that it's assigning the whole block into one underscore. So underscore times underscore means that this number times itself for how many times here? So it goes to 16 times itself 8 times.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
5 times. So you can use the same symbol to do this operation to get a larger number. Another one is how to make a string using symbol. It's using ASCII code. So for this one, you can start with empty string, then you insert a 72. So a 72 will result in H, and then 101, 108, 108. So it's L, L, and O. So you can code with your ASCII code and put it inside so that it will return you characters in a string format. So for this example, you can see it's actually returning hello.
Right.
How to print a string? You just feed it into the SED out. So it will write to the IO. So it's a dollar sign and an arrow. So this is the SED out. Just a dollar sign and an arrow. With all the techniques, you can break it down. So to feed in HI, you first you break it into numbers 72, 105. Then you further break it down into symbols. Because you have numbers, right? You break it into symbols. So you slowly decipher more and more stuff until in the end you get this all symbol, but it'll give you a high. So next thing will be introduced is a client. So a program that prints its source code. So a program that prints up its own code, like metaprogramming. Codes that generate codes. So to do a client, basically you need to wrap eval and then do whatever here. Means whatever you want to do, you can just put it here. You just print up. So, like this one, puts hello world. You just need to wrap inside eval and join. So eval and join. And then now you can shape it whatever you like. So you can make a square, you can make Mickey Mouse, whatever, a flower. It still will give you a creative way of presenting the code. So quite related. What is client relay? A program that generates 100 plus programming language and over again, and it compiles perfectly. So, from here you can see that it's doing a whole round circle. The code that runs on code that runs on code. So, means from query, it generates the code for D, it compiles in D, then it generates the code for definity, and then runs in definity, it runs in DC and DC. Continue to run every programming language throughout the circle. So this guy, Mame, he produced this kind of point relay. So you can see here, first it runs Ruby, then it creates a Rust code. Then it uses the Rust code to generate a Scala code, and then continue to run. So we can see that the code is actually working for
all actually working fine. So we can check out the code, how it generates. So this is the result of the code. So every time it will generate similar patterns of this on your terminal. So it runs, and then for next language it will be the same thing. It runs, continues runs. This is the Trascendo Ruby Imbroglio contest. It means how to create Ruby in a creative way, like how to write Ruby in a creative way. It's a competition to test your creativity and try to make you think of how to hack the compiler to do things that you want to do. So, open this GitHub. So these are the entries of trick competition. The trick competition also includes like C++, Perl. They also have a trick competition where you can write codes that do fun stuff. So I have the entries for 2013 and 18. You can look on that. Just now we touched about quite something like this. So let me run in a separate terminal. Quite. We print out hello world. And then loop. Loop is a diff, it's quite fun. So this is how we run loop and how loop look like is loop. Actually it needs to fall a bit. It actually looks like this. It's an ASCII picture and you will see it turn, right? All that. So let's try maximize. So when you run the code, it actually makes the ASCII. Go round and round. So a code that generates a code and then keep on running back the output of that code and run. So it's a relay. So you create a coin and then you make it relay. You continuously running the code that generated itself, then the code that generated out, run on it, it still produce another code. So this is how we use a coin relay. Let's go for Trick 2013 is quite old. Not everything is working. I try a few, it's not. So, like this is Alice in Wonderland. So you can write an essay and it still compiled perfectly. But it's running on Ruby 1.8 or 1.9, so I don't have that at the moment. So we can Trick, the latest one. One of the interesting one, I think, is so most of the stuff is from Japan. Yeah, apparently Japan like this kind of stuff. Try to make fun use of people. There's a lot of language doing this also, so you can look up JavaScript. Having this also. I remember there's one Christmas tree. This one is generating an SQL file. So basically create a code that generates a last line by the end of the code. This is also interesting. It's an animation that is also a file, a code running on itself. So let me run this. So it runs like this, and it's the same file, just running the output. So you can generate the output and then run the output, so it's just keep continuing running. So all this are Ruby code. If I do output, means after it finishes all this code, it will still be able to run the same output using C. So it's, you can see here it's using C, so it's slowly print out one by one. Okay. We do the output. Generates code runs again. So this one way of doing it, you can try to do it on your language. If you want to run it on JavaScript, feel free to try it. Just need to understand like how you can do it in JavaScript to make it go run. Right. Honorable mentions. All this stuff, I think it's quite fun to check out because they try to create a story around the code that they write. You can do fun stuff while using the trick from your language. So if you know that JavaScript has a certain way of doing things, you can try to exploit it and try to do things differently. It's fun to just try out with your language. So for Ruby, it's very flexible. That's why you can do many, many things with it. This is one of it. Ruby is calling. That's one. Even write Japanese and it still compiles. So I think would be I need to find it where is that after that can show you guys afterwards. So so do try to like explore what you can do with using simple generic codes or fun stuff to do with your language, even in JavaScript, Python, whatever language that you can think of, just try and be creative. So that's it from me. All these are all the references that I use to use these slides, especially this multimedia. This is Japanese. The first one. It shares on LinkedIn. So this guy does all this creative stuff, and he has a book on how to make your code not readable so that you can deploy to production and all the stuff. So it creates a tool to compile the okay. That's it. Let's go to the next speaker.
So I guess other than the main part, I mean the number is powerful. But the other side like how awesome part of other than files, but is that probably useful if you're like maybe one of say something like your metrics?
I would say this one is not really for production.
Okay.
It's really meant for hobbies.
Yeah.
Want to play with movie.
Yeah.
I don't think is there any use case? Not really. Yeah, because it pushes your limits to understand the language itself.
Yeah.
Because if you think hard enough, you know the inside and out of the language or compilers, then you can fix things differently.
So he said that
he knows, he reads a lot of compilers, so he knows how those compilers shapes the character. So yes, this guy is smart. Interesting guy, you can check out his work. He writes on how to explore languages, I think. Any languages in general, not just Ruby.
Transforming
from my language, we really want to import it. We really want to use it. Yes. Stable and formatted. Correct.
So
fancy
and
then we import
it. Correct.
It's like meta programming. So you write the code to run on the server where it runs on like Python. You know that server installed Python before, right? So you can run your code that generates a Python code to run on the server to trigger something. So it's code running codes. And you can generate a bash file to run on the server also. So you won't know that that script actually triggered another action because it's hidden inside the code. So this is one of the meta programming that's fun to play with.
Let's go with
JS Design Python with Xian Xiong. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. It's okay. Yes.
Talk about how I screw up at work and some of the things that I use. to make my work less troublesome. So anyway, build, if I start 2014, and yeah, right now it's at 2.6.10 for the stable versions, if you don't want to go for the leading edge stuff. This one is much more stable, has much more documentation and much more support, so if you're going to use it for production, this is the one that I would recommend. Good for UIs and SDAs, so I'm using SDA and then hosting it on my Electron platform. So, one thing that drew me to it was that it was very easy to pick up, even though I was like self-taught. So, and then all of the features could be incrementally added onto it, so you don't have to deal with all the bloat in one go. So yeah, it's pretty framework with a pretty like lenient learning curve. So quick trivia: these are all the versions of Vue. So they actually use all sorts of Asian Git names that came up, starting from 0.9. I think after Ben Brandon was appropriating the most Western naming, then all of it turns into anime names. Okay, so Electron, so many companies using it. It's a cross-platform desktop application framework that you can use web technologies on. Nonetheless, say so popular. So the combination of Vue.js and Electron is handled by some guy called Simulated Brick. So he used this as a framework, a boilerplate framework to quickly make Electron applications with Vue.js. So with this framework, it actually uses scaffolding. So you can add or remove multiple Vue features very easily. And it has quite a lot of support for Windows API or any desktop APIs that you need to use. So yeah, moving on to the patterns that I use. So one of the great things of Vue is that it's a single file component. Actually, there's three parts of it: templating, scripting, and styling. You can also build them all in one file. And by having that, using Vue VS Code is strongly supported on Vue. So we have this extension where you can actually have the full syntax highlighting, linting, and also you can also have scope your scripts and your styles to one page. So for a quick demo, HTML tags, but these are just something that combines Angular and HTML together, so it helps out a lot with the design decisions, I would say. And so you will put in a template, and then you will put in a main component, and inside it you will have some sort of a header and a content, and you could also have this like decorative functions where you can just import actually stuff from your scripts. So scripts, you have your JavaScript here. You have your mains and your props. So you can actually have it has the best practices to do communications between the parent and child components. So this is one of the examples that I will go through later, props. And eventually down there you can actually make your own styles, like styles. Can have CSS code with Vue. I think CSS a little less, or all the other kinds of like preprocessors that you would probably know, like a stylus and I guess other stuff. So the next part would be component communication. So it actually helps out to this. The best practices to do for communications between components from the parent to child is always good practices of one-way data flow. So from parent to child is always a prop downwards, and from the child upwards is always anything and event. So the prompts are rendered automatically, so you just reactively listen to whatever changes that happen in your parent data. And the parent components like react to it. So in this part, So this is an example of it. Top part would be a parent component. It's like dictating what the child can listen to, what it will listen to from the child. And then the V-on, V-on bindings. So they are bindings to functions. From events from the child. So the child emits the event host, and then the parent will have a post function there where it will be triggered when it's emitted from the child. So in the child component, like the dialog of alert, so there is the, this is a variable where it is actually passing down a prompt to the child. So this is actually the alert message would be a data component in the parent, similar to what we have here. Data component. Let me see. Let's get data component. So this is a data component where actually you have your mini component states over here, and then for contrasts between components, you will use this data to call your state and you alert the pass on variables of data towards other components in your app. Yes. Okay. So the other part of it would be like component communications. So this is a part where actually you will admit an event, and then you pass on your variables, data up towards the parent, and the parent will listen to it, and it will automatically trigger whatever functions that you have written into it. So the other part of Vue.js that you have is that you can have conditional rendering on your templates. So simply by adding a directives of VAPRs, ETLs, if, and VShow, you can dictate whether or not the component will show a certain behavior or it will show a certain styling. So like this, so you can show like three choices of alternate characters A, B, C, depending on what the type variable was and data or by from. Alright, then you can also define in your data part, you can have certain default variables or yes and no conditions like true ternary operators. So, like this is a greeting, hello is quite normal, it's a variable with a value. So, goodbye is a variable with that can take a prop or a prop. Or you can just have a default value of sayonara. Then in minus here, you can have a boolean expression, a ternary operator to decide whether or not to put the word if there or have it empty. So that is one of the things that I use to quickly cycle through conditional rendering, like whether or not I want to show this thing to the user, or do I want to have this thing styled in a different way. It's easily to change the data, so like prepare just in case you get a blank data sheet or anything, so your app will not crash on the way. Alright, so we have routers in Vue.js. So router is also set up automatically if you use the Vue Electron framework. And then through here, actually I just wanted to highlight this like conditional router. It's like very similar to Ruby, where you just put in sort of a variable in the router tab. And then you can allocate different, you can like sort of go through the pages or the units with identity numbers. So in this part, we can get the data from the database and then it can be passed into export the data, is to two exporter detail, and then we add in the batch ID. So you just sort it in, and then you will just ask the server for the page or the component that, or the data that you want.
So it's like a really simple JavaScript kind of like Ruby's OK and stuff.
So we also have state management in Vue using the library called Vuex. It's quite dark, but actually Vuex is broken up into several parts. So this is the store where Vuex generates when it's first imported. And then you can have data, modules, and also the whole index itself. So in data is generally like enumerables and constants where you'll be using them in your modules. And modules are supposedly smaller parts of the app that you could call. So like you can have the OS and then all the stuff. And then you can just call them in. You can call it in from other modules and just use them instantly inside. So modules are designed to break up your the logic part of the store state management to be have it more easily manageable. Or you can end up usually with very long central state where you have like thousands of lines of code which I'm still struggling with, to be honest. So like 1,884 lines of centralized functions, which is quite a mess to handle, so I try to use modules as much as you can. So there are four main components of the state management. So there are states, actions, mutations, and getters. So all these are design decisions that will make life much more easier when you're separating your doing your state management. So state as it is where data is stored, what the app state is, and everything can refer back to it as the centralized store. Actions is the functions that will change the state, or it will get data to change the states. So what actually changes the states are actually mutations. They can only be changed through mutations to, preserve the integrity of the state. So components, child components of your app do not accidentally change it by mistake. That's always referred back to the store in actions, and then actions will call mutations, and then only it will change whatever is happening on locally on your app. So getters is a part of the filter part. So this is state where you can just have variables and values. Actions are a bit more or less hard to see, but I can show it. I'm going to show a very embarrassing part of my view, which is alright. So this is an action that you can actually put in JavaScript logic into it. Here I'm using a promise, which is when I start up the app, I want to get everything ready before going onwards. And you can like call your APIs through here, and then once it's done, you will commit it through mutation, and it will be committed up to your state, so you will be understanding of what happens in the state. Then afterwards, you can also like set up the intervals to continuously renew your app and keep the app running. So that was actions. So mutations and getters. So mutations are quite simple enough actually. They are just like calls to what sort of variables you have in your state. I've actually tried to make it generalized, like having just one mutation saying that this is the variable I want you to change and this is the value I want you to change, and then just take these two and go and change whatever you need in the state. In the end, it turned out it happens to be a very long mess because I couldn't keep track of who was changing what and what was changing where, and everyone was like going through the general function of the mutation. So it ended up like a very sort of debugging hell when you want to look for whatever change in the state. And then when you have the console, there is printing, keep on printing up all the lifecycle
junk that comes up. So it's better to keep things clear, like initialize when you change initialize, time when you change time, and stuff like that. So that was a lesson that I learned. And now, getters. Well, getters. We are doing very fast. So getters are like functions you can, functions or filters that are mainly, their main purpose is to do some processing of the data you have in your state, so you can use them more easily. So like some say, some functions will back this kind of data, but the other function will have something derived from that data, you can use a getter to get, to set up something like a clock. So state.now is actually date.now. And then if you wanted to get a clock, you can use a getter to say, use a getter clock, and just process the state.now into a numeric function that you can just output in your component. You can just call it, refer it directly. So since this one is done in the centralized form, it saves time like doing it repeatedly in your components or having like somewhere. It should be done in a module, to be honest, but here it is in my centralized form.
Okay. Alright, yes, that's about me. What I have is my references. JS document, Vue.js documentation is quite good. And actually, there are quite a lot of like, third parties writings that are freely available. And the JS design patterns are actually referred to any Osmani essential JS documents, design patterns. So this is a great book that is available online. You can get it freely. I encourage you to look it up to be better at doing JavaScript for them. So yep, that's all from me. Thank you for listening. That's all I can do.
For the just now you mentioned about data under the module, right? Or sorry. One file. That's the data. Is it a
so every work? Component in Vue has a data data section where you can do sort of component state.
So it's a prop. Once the prop is passed in, it's moving that data.
A prop remains a prop, but a prop can be stored in the data to be like a separate state. Or you can use it as a prop directly and then just display it. So it will be useful to display like repeating elements like list items or how to say repeating components. You just put in the prop there and then link the prop to the UI, to the markup section, and you can just repeat it. Then you can just go through in your parent app, you would call the sort of API to get the data, maybe a JSON format. And then you can loop through the JSON format and then for each loop, ask Vue.js to generate one of the child's with props. And then you can just pop it downwards in a container. Then in the container, you can just like progressively generate it. So yeah, any questions about Vue.js?
So recently, Electron got vulnerability to patch your own.
Yeah, that's the thing. I think around 40 billion computers affected, projected. Zero day as well.
So you patch the...
They patch, I think they were aware of it for around 6 months. Then only recently, like, it became the news. And hopefully they patched it. We'll check you about it. So, yeah, one of the parts of using an open source.
But it's good because it's announced to people that quickly go and help it.
Yeah. So while doing these slides also I learned that there is right now electron.net. So for .net developers you can stay within your C# bubble and still do cross-platform programming. But you need to use ASP.net core, the second version. So yeah, thank you.
Okay. Okay, so last track, what can I help you? So I've been experimenting this track since last meetup. I think it's very helpful to get response from the crowd, like what you have issue in the work or any question that you ask, so that the people in the room can help you. Because we last time we had one student and one just startup entrepreneur wanted to learn something,
the question that they ask, then we help them to solve. I think it's a very good way to get engaged some topics that we didn't cover. So it's back to the crowd that you have any questions that you want to get help with all of us are developers, we have certain experience on certain technologies, then we can give some suggestions. So we open to the floor. Any questions? Not at the start first. So I have a problem implementing Swagger. If you heard about Swagger, it's an open API standards to document your API. I'm trying to integrate it with Java. So yeah, I work with Java and Python. But it's work. So anyhow, I need to integrate with Spring Boot and Jersey. If it's standalone Spring Boot or standalone Jersey, it will be just fine. But somehow our team decided to merge them
together. What do you want to achieve?
We built API using Java, but we want to document it in Swagger. The problem we have is that we're not able to find a way to generate appropriate Swagger documentation. Because there's a lot of...
We have open API version 3.1,
yes.
I guess.
Yes, yes.
Isn't enough?
For Java, we need to go through a Maven repository, yeah. The library. Currently, there's two options that I can think of. One is the Swagger V2. Another one is SpringFox. So SpringFox supports Spring.
So you want to automatically generate your...
Yes. Yeah, according to Java code. So once it get into the projects, when it runs, it automatically generates an open API.json. So that the Swagger UI can consume and display.
If I remember, the Spring has Spring Docs.
Spring Docs,
But I tried Spring Fox and it worked a bit, but maybe currently Spring Docs can do more advanced stuff.
Is it Spring Docs or?
Yes, Spring. Spring generation,
generate or I've been using a few options. This one looks nearest to me, but it's slow. I would say old because it still starts on Swagger version 1. Because now it's Swagger 3, it's open API 3, so it's still the older version. It's using.
Why do you need to generate? Why do you need this automatic way of generating your API based on your code? Why?
Because we want to pass to other teams to integrate our API. So that's the main reason. Like if we updated our API in a new format or introducing new APIs, we want to immediately able to just pass it to the next team to integrate without manually writing our API.
Are you sure that automatic way of generating your API will be good? I mean, all automatic ways usually can come with simple stuff. But if you have some complex stuff, you will have really huge pain in your ass of trying to fix this.
Yes, makes sense. That's what we trying to like balance it up because I already spent like 2 weeks on this. Trying to integrate doesn't have any success rate yet because I tried SpringFox, I tried this one. The nearest I can get is to come up with a Swagger UI that feed in some generated JSON, but the format just off a lot. It will be quicker for me to just write a text file, a README, because my API just one. I only had just one API, but they wanted me to create Swagger for just one API. That's the manager decision because he wanted in the long run to be easier in the future. He wanted me to start early before things get complicated. But for now, I only have 4 APIs and only one API service in the container. I think the README serves the purpose because it gives all the usage, how to use the response, what the response. But still, he got his point because in the long run, we still need the documentation. So I'm looking at what are others options other than Swagger. Is there any options that we can like document our API without writing manually? Because I know that if you want to create an API documentation, that's one way is to write the test so that your test will serve as your API documentation.
Okay, I will give you an example because currently we also work with Swagger and so on, and the usual process backend implementation first, then backend implementer also define the Swagger implementation, open API, and then front end read this open API specification and implement the front end implementation. So, for example, you have updating point for an entity. And based on your business logic, maybe, for example, for your entity have, has 10 fields. But to create your entity, you need the 3 fields and mandatory. How you will define it in automated code?
Because when you pass in a method, you need to pass in the variables, right? So for Swagger, you will scan through the package in Java package, then it will go through the variables that pass into the method, and then it will generate those documentation based on that beats. So that's how Swagger works. Yes. Correct. What's Swagger? Correct. So,
do you know what is open API?
So Swagger is a whole, I would say the whole way of saying the open API. Now they change it to open API. It's a standard.
Okay. Can you show the Swagger editor?
Yes. Yes.
Like
any
language.
Any language, yes.
Okay.
So in Ruby, previously we used Swagger library. In Java, they also use this because now they changed to open API. It's only, it's strongly supported on JSON format, so it's very easy to integrate to any major platform.
By the way, do you use YAML format when you are?
I use JSON format. Swagger.json.
Because when you have YAML, you forget those missing curly brackets and so on. So, YAML.
Yeah, because it's indented, right? Correct. In YAML is indented.
Otherwise, JSON has a lot of these validation rules, but in YAML you can trick some of them.
Yes, true. I'm still finding options to like how to make it easier for me to continue my class because there's lots of documentation. Mostly outdated, like this one. I try to use similar stuff using OpenAPI, generate this kind of document, which I can't make it generate. It doesn't work for me, it worked for him. The only thing that worked for me is actually this one. You can see there's a YAML file to define a different servlet. So in Java, we have servlets, I would say the app instance. So one is running on the root path, one is running on API. So for my jersey, it runs on API, and then the root path, I have no idea what it's running on. Because I try to access the health and the info on Swinwood, doesn't allow me to access. So something wrong with the configuration that I cannot find out. In the end, I will get something like this. So this is the one that I'm able to get into the end. Still finding way, finding options to make it a lot easier. So let's see whether I can get an example. So this is not the one I want. So for jersey, can see how it defines here. Configuration is a bit weird, but it works something like this. So for jersey, you need to register the endpoint. For here, it registers the API listing resource from Swagger. And Swagger serializer, which serializes your API. And then you configure your bin. And set the scan. This is your resource package, means your endpoint. Where is your endpoint? So I put it here. And it scans somehow correctly and somehow not, because it duplicates the endpoints. So let's say I have like book API. I will see two book API there. One is book with a label, and then another one is under a default. So something in the configuration which I didn't configure correctly somewhere, still trying to figure out. It's quite hard to debug when it's a lot of automation here, because you have beans, you have this kind of push construct. So how the library gel with Spring Boot and Jersey, it's very hard to see the flow. That's why it's like very difficult to debug, trying a lot of ways. Still, yeah. In the end, we might not proceed with it if we have issue, because I saw a team implementing it previously. In the end, I only see their configs, the whole library being scrapped. So I think they tried, somehow it doesn't work for them. But now I'm retrying again to make it whether it works or not. We'll see how, whether it works.
Is that actually like very close to the state of that caused by the way you run it?
It's more on the library, how we understand the framework and how the library behaves. Because there isn't much documentation on the library itself, like how to use it with different frameworks. Because I'm using both Spring Boot and Jersey together, the Java SR or RX together. So it's like, it's violating each other convention per se. Because Jersey have its own way of defining APIs, and Spring Boot have its own way of starting their Spring Boot server or servlet. So it's somehow need to find a way to make it work properly. So yeah, it's a behavior of the library. Standard Java docs apply to Java language, but in framework wise, they have ways of doing things. They have conventions. That's the way. That's the part where I'm getting confused, because it's a lot of ways. Yeah, it's opinionated somehow. Correct. Yeah, that's the thing. I started with Spring Boot REST. It's the purest way of writing API. But when the reviewer come to review my code,
I'm sure a lot of respect and agree.
When reviewer come to review my code, he added in the Jersey part. That's when the thing get haywire, because I have no idea what being added to my code. And then yeah, because he used to work with Jersey, he's very fluent in doing that, so he just added, because most of our company code base already been refactored to follow his way of doing things. So we want to make unified way of doing things, means if he's doing one style of writing the code, everyone should follow, so that it's easier to maintain in the future. Not everyone has his own code style, then very hard to maintain. So that's the thing, that if you want to stick to the convention, then yeah, then we need to maintain it. So it's a company effort to maintain it.
One guy in car, he just find everything like that, right?
You have that issue before?
Yeah.
I remember maintaining a Scala project. He asked me to continue with it. It's been done for 7 years. No one touched it before. So in the end, I redo it in Python faster than reading through the Scala code. So yeah, it's the efficiency of doing things. They don't object me doing Python because most of our team know how to write Python. So there's no issue. In comparison for Scala, I don't think anyone knows how to write Scala on my team. It's fast, but too time to pick up. Really time to pick up.
For example, we do use Swagger
Hub,
but we use it as a documentation first.
Yes.
So we didn't go for the afterwards. You give the code first, then you generate documentation by itself. But for us, we use the documentation.
We have this before. Let me see whether I still have my code.
Should we run out to white?
Really?
I can see nothing.
Let's see how to change. Yeah. Where's the color?
Yeah, what color?
This one? Or background?
Try
something. Profiles in the second tab.
Profiles, okay.
Yeah.
Background. Colors. This one.
Yeah.
White. Black and white.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Let me see whether I can get my stuff in. Previously, we have this for. We write it in our test. Because we generate our API also.
So that's
something like this. So for API auto-generating, basically we need to write a test in Rails. You define the path, then you define the action, like post-login, you tag, what is the tag, consume what, produce what are the parameters, and then what are the response code. So you are writing the test before you can generate your API. So you're actually making sure that your API is working as expected when you are writing your documentation. Because this is actually saying that, okay, expect authorization, expect UID. It will show up on your documentation. All this. So if it's incorrect, the response is incorrect. So you will generate the swagger for incorrect. Yes. Yeah. So you run the Swagger, you auto generate all the API endpoints on Swagger with the test file that we have here. So you just need to repeat because the convention is the upper part. All this the upper part. And then RSpec will read it correctly and run it correctly, so won't have problem with that. Okay, any more questions on your work, anything that you want to try?
Anybody has experience with building microservice architecture with Node.js, any Node.js frameworks? No? Not yet? Yeah, not just like next.
Well, we are trying to, we are going to write our old Java monolithic application to microservice, and we already choose Node.js framework loopback. Anybody think about it?
Loopback. Yeah.
But because we didn't test what is this framework and this framework allowed to build our quite big microservice architecture. Yeah, by the way, this framework also generates a documentation on the line.
Oh,
yeah.
Nice.
You can understand. So you write your code in TypeScript.
GraphQL.
Then it can generate your OpenMDI documentation.
Do you try Apollo? Apollo.
Yeah.
Apollo.
Apollo.
Yeah.
No. Didn't have time to try.
It's also GraphQL.
Yeah, GraphQL is
but yeah, it's another basically GraphQL stuff. It's interesting to back. Microservices, do you plan to run it on, like, how do you plan to deploy Kubernetes or containers?
Yeah, probably containers, Docker containers, maybe use Kubernetes, and we have rented cloud, some cloud, so.
It doesn't have states, right, or you, do you have states in your, like, microservices? For each of the microservices, like from service 1 to service 2, there will be a state where you need to have a queue, or you will be stateless, means anything can happen inside a microservices graph.
Well, you know that states, you can manage different ways. You can use database to
right.
store states, you can use messaging queue, you can use some kind of gateway that will collect your request and then pass request to different resources. So it can be done in different ways.
We have similar microservices for our what we call our crawler. We crawl the web on our client side and then distributed our crawlers into like screenshots and also URL crawlers with that search, and we are using parser. So it means our crawler is Python based. It goes through a website, search for links, visit the links, pass the links to the next screenshot service, which is Puppeteer. We use Puppeteer, and then Puppeteer will proceed fetch that links screenshots, pass back, store into our data store. In Google Cloud. So our microservices run 5x5, and then we're using PubSub to manage the connection between.
So we just use this PubSub?
Yeah.
To just manage the communication between your microservices?
Yes, because they have time and they can, how to say, broadcast to different teams. Queues, because each of the workers are consuming different queues, which is quite effective. And Spotify is using it. They have an engineering blog post about how to use it for their services.
Well, my question was mostly about the production usage. When you use Node.js in production, especially when you build microservices. Because when you speak about Node.js, production, maybe for smaller projects, but maybe for big projects and Node.js, I don't have experience with that, but I'm curious.
True also. Interesting. Node.js in production, microservices, it's using Go. VictorJar is using Go. Golang. The nearest one
here, not much people use microservices. Not really.
But it's a very powerful, I would say, in based on conference like JSConf, that they have a lot of ways of using Node.js to scale their infra. The thing is that Node.js is still running on single thread, right? It's non-blocking, but it's still on single thread.
Yeah.
So if you break up into containers, then it will be faster because it's just one core per container. But
yeah,
microservices. Sure, people have done it before. Just need to find who deployed to production. Yeah. But converting Java monolith to microservices, that is a very relational versus non-relational database, let's say. The fields are not consistent. If you are using NoSQL, means you expect the data field to change. Like the keys, you don't have to have the same key every time you save the data. You might have extra keys in a new iteration next. But for relational database, all the fields must be listed so that you can query faster.
Yeah, and that's why the 21.7 is so popular. One but means, like to me, I think it's the code itself that you can do powerful with structured code, perhaps, and then it's for now. But I'm trying to convince people to say that.
No SQL use case, I saw the best use case is using ELK, Elasticsearch. So we have a lot of logs, big data, and then you can use specified ways to query your logs, very huge logs in a very short time. So, and then you don't have to think about how to like normalize your tables.
Yeah.
That's a use case, big use case.
But for normal use case, relational works fine because Postgres support JSON binary. You can search JSON using JSON format to do the query in Postgres. MySQL, I think they have supported in newer version of RDB. So you still can store JSON and query JSON on the database itself because they saw it very popular right now, so they integrate that feature.
So you send the JSON object to the
yep.
database
and then you define the column as JSON. There's a type called JSON. Normally you have varchar or numbers, they have a type called JSON. You can store the whole JSON. Yeah.
You can
just
store
JSON. We used it before to query JSON. So you can store the whole JSON into that column and then you query with this.
Yeah.
Indexing wise, not sure. Need to see whether they have the performance or not. The benchmark. To see if they have benchmark. But yeah, you can do a query on it so that you don't have to purposely convert a whole JSON into the appropriate column. Just throw the thing in and then just query it afterwards. Supporting old system, and you just add one column, it supports it, then you have to change. Yeah. But how to decide? That's also a big question. Like, we have a project right now that wanted to switch from MySQL to Mongo.
Switch.
Yeah. Which I don't agree. I don't want to switch to Mongo because I think the use case is not there. If you want to use Mongo, you need to define why Mongo better than MySQL in that use case, like the program itself, what feature you need for Mongo, why you want to switch. If there isn't a reason to switch, then why you want to start with it in the first place? Because Mongo, I wouldn't say it's bad, but I'm not familiar with Mongo. So if you want me to like get a performance up with Mongo, I can't really do. But MySQL, I can improve the performance because I know how to write a correct query to get the highest performance through MySQL. Interesting, yes, that one is interesting. It's a JavaScript project. If it's Mongo, it's easier to write, I understand. Just pass in as well. The foreign key.
Yes, you understand. It's the documentation itself.
So it's still, for me, because I'm comfortable with relational database, I will still stick with MySQL or Postgres. Mongo, maybe, if it's forced to do so, yes, I will throw it. If it's a must requirement, I will still convince them to still use that MySQL or Postgres, if possible. Because that's. First is migration.
I have a similar project right now, which is creating this stuff.
You need to dump the MySQL out as a JSON file. You can dump it as JSON. I tried before, it works. You need to escape certain fields because for my case, our database store the whole HTML files. So you know HTML files? and all those escape stuff.
Foolish.
Then when I try to pass the data, it's painful. But once you get into the correct JSON file, then you can feed it to the Mongo. Just dump it in. Then it will find. Performance wise, perhaps that. But yeah, if it's insist, then no choice. It's like we have one project, it asks us to use Google Cloud SQL.
Cloud SQL?
Yeah. Cloud SQL is just a table, right? Everything you just write to a table with a kind. There's a kind namespace. You define what is a data namespace and then you just insert. So, let's see whether can use my personal account. So, whether I can access or not, let's see. I reached the free tier finish already. I don't have free credit anymore. So, let's see whether I can. So basically you create an entity, then it will still be in one table, one big table. So you differentiate your data with namespace and also the time. The bad thing about this is that it allows one write per second, which is not fast enough for our key use case. We try to benchmark it, we just keep on writing because our process crawler, so we need to write a lot of stuff. It doesn't meet our benchmark, so we switch to Couchbase. Yeah. It's still NoSQL. Is it NoSQL? Yeah. It's a NoSQL database. There are two versions. One is the community version, one is the enterprise. Couchbase is used by a lot of big data companies. So you can do MapReduce on Couchbase. You write JavaScript to do MapReduce, then it will do fun stuff with data science. There's a, I checked before, performance.
I thought Couchbase is dead already.
It's old. Yes, it's old. Somehow I still need to do it. I have Couchbase running on my laptop because it's needed for my work. Yeah. I have a Docker container with Couchbase because I need it. And then there's one thing about Couchbase is that if you deploy on Google Compute Engine, you can't open up the Couchbase port. It doesn't allow you to do that. So it only lives inside the compute engine local network entity. So if you want to access your Couchbase outside of Google Compute Engine, you can't. That's the downside. Unless you use the enterprise version, which you need to pay one point something K per month USD. Able to hit 1 million bytes per second. If you are really crazy about big data, this is the one. You run it, benchmark. So, you can achieve that performance if you pay.
So, what
about
the databases? What
do you
want
to do
with the
Typeface?
Typeface?
EnoDB? EnoDB is MySQL engine, right? EnoDB can be used with MySQL. I remember I used EnoDB before in MySQL.
What's the key? We are using MySQL at the moment, but we want to have better query times with a lot of series of logs. We have a lot of logs. Since our logs are based on times, I think they use it for financial records previously.
Elasticsearch. ELK log stash Kibana stash. Maybe you can try log stash.
Log stash and Elasticsearch. Kibana is just the tool to visualize your data.
You can check out this Elasticsearch. If you want to have an efficient Elasticsearch service, you need multiple servers. I remember one is for querying, one is for processing, one is for something. It's quite process intense, but if you want to host everything in just one server, you can use Kubernetes to run your containers. It's fine.
Last time we do log parsing, we use Splunk.
But it's a big service, now it's no more. Previously it's free. Splunk. You heard about Datadog? I think it's Datadog. It's also doing log management. Datadog.
But this is not a simple solution. This is
very
big part of the big management system.
This is a big solution. But if you want to do ELK, okay,
then you need to wait for it.
Logstash. Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch.
Elasticsearch is a search.
Optimizing for search. Normally, if you want to store it, it's log stash. It's based on JRuby. Last time I checked, it's JRuby. It runs on JRuby. It's basically Java JVM, but running on Ruby.
Okay. So that's what's
log stash? Log stash. One of the popular ones. Any other solution?
This is popular in SQL search.
Fluentd? Is Fluentd? You heard about Fluentd? It's also a big data set. You can check out. It's similar to Elasticsearch. I don't think you do a lot of big data stuff. You normally just want to analyze. In Grafana also can. Depends what you want to display. Yeah.
Just that the JSON thing object comes to the need so long.
This is one good way to aggregate data. You will send all the data to Prometheus instance. It's open source. It's also part of the Linux thing. I don't know. It replaces Najos. Previously it's Najos. Now they change to Prometheus. So you can run a POC with this. You just need to grab the container image and then run it to try it out. I do it before, it's okay lah. It's basically you can decide what metrics you want it to display.
display as red or green, because sometimes you don't want to see all those tags. You don't want to see, you just want to aggregate, okay, is this green or red?
Yeah.
You want to do yes or no only. You don't care what it is. You just need to set. It's good for aggregating. And it's open source, so it's free. Other metrics are Nagios and Union. Those two are the oldest. Nagios and Union. Union. It's very old also. If you do like server side DevOps in very old time, then yeah, you'll see this quite a lot. It keeps all the logs off your server.
We will get people from Facebook, like if you have events like a hackathon
or any workshops that you require help from Facebook, they will send engineers from San Francisco or Singapore to here to help us with workshops, because we get direct support with Facebook on community events. So if you have any events in mind that you want to host, or you have any feedback, please let me know, or Natasha, so we can host something like that. We have three tracks currently Facebook is focusing on. Data, ML, machine learning, VR, because they have Oculus, and web development with React. So React meetup will be starting soon by Dong Tian. So he'll be leading on Google. So it's good to see more and more developers, different groups of developers coming to Penang, and Facebook is helping us. So if we need any help from Facebook, they are okay with helping us do anything.
Just what was the difficulties met by the KL
function? Finding the right person, I think. Yeah, their criteria is a bit strict, I would say. To help them to run the events, because you need to have certain commitment and you have certain experience of running multiple events before, then you will start picking those people. No, I haven't heard developer circle KL, so we are basically the first in Asia for now, and then we can help other city. They okay with us to help other city to start Dev C events. If needed, they will give us more budget to do stuff. More photos. They want photos and event stories, like success stories, something like that. So. But if you need support from like the React core team, they're able to help with that. Or just need engineers to help your hackathons. They hope us to create one hackathon this year, but can't. We don't have that time yet. Maybe next year.
One of the ideas that we found out was when we do like a small competition for UDS, VNDS.
Maybe we can plan that for the end of the year, because I know
maybe more
we have Angular developers here. They just have their Angular JS conf in KL past few months. So it's possible to try out different events and stuff. So keep an eye on developer circles on 24th August. We're giving out t-shirts and stickers. Sorry. Okay. Last note, take attendance. And see, yeah, the contrast is bad. So I need to take attendance, and if you want to help out tech communities in Penang, like tech meetups in Penang, talk to me. I know certain groups are looking for people to become speakers, like the data group, the data analytics, the Python group, which are very active now. They are looking for speakers.
Why Malaysia doesn't have job group?
I'm actually planning to substitute one Java topic under this meetup, but depends, we'll see how. Because it's very hard to find people from the Java community to come up. Because those are enterprise people. I know a few Java. There are two Java developers come to the Python group meetup before. I don't know where they work with, but we have two Java developers there. Hopefully there will be more. Let's see. If you want to start one, just start. We will help out. We will help out. Definitely will help out to get people.
Started to go to my mind in JavaScript, so okay. JavaScript.
But yeah, just talk to me if you want to help out any meetups or you want to start posting anything. We will get resources for you. Okay? Okay, thank you for being here. See you in the next meetup. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.